This is part 2 of a 3-part video essay on progestins in hormonal contraception. In part 1, I went over progestins classification and steroid hormone receptor activity patterns. And in this part 2, I am going to go into combined hormonal oral contraceptives and the generations of COCs. So actually in CHCs, the main contraceptive effect comes from the progestin, but adding estrogen enhances the contraceptive effect. I'll go more into this in part 3. So combined hormonal contraception means it contains both progestin and estrogen. So actually the first combined hormonal product was actually marketed to help control and regulate menstrual bleeding in women. And it was then they discovered it had the side effect of preventing pregnancies. Not long after, they started marketing it directly as a contraceptive, and that was the dawn of the birth control pill. The first pill contained norethisterone and the estrogen megestrol, which isn't really used very much anymore. They then discovered that it caused adverse effects, including a venous thromboembolism, and they started reducing the hormone doses in the pill formulations over time until they discovered that they didn't actually need estrogen at all for the contraceptive effect. But without estrogen, they found that breakthrough bleeding occurred more often in progestogen-only preparations, which a lot of women didn't like. And plus, the first progestin-only pills were not considered to be as effective because they weren't able to inhibit ovulation consistently. The estrogen component reduces breakthrough bleeding significantly and also enhances the contraceptive effect of the formula. So currently the standard estrogen used in most combined hormonal contraceptions, abbreviate this to CHC, is ethinylestradiol. And ethinylestradiol is a synthetic derivative of estradiol, and it has better bioavailability and a longer half-life than estradiol. However, it is associated with the notorious adverse effect of venous thromboembolism. Newer pill formulations with lower ethinyl estradiol are available, but with these, breakthrough bleeding becomes more likely again. There are formulations using estradiol instead of ethinyl estradiol, so I'll talk about that later on. Here are the main side effects relating to estrogen. Some are adverse and some are beneficial. Some of these may be opposed by the progestin it is paired with. I will come back to cancer risks associated with CHC in part 3. Estrogen has a protective effect on the heart and the bones, so these effects may also be opposed in part by progestin. This chart shows the fluctuating hormone levels in a woman that has menstrual cycles. So when you regularly take exogenous hormones, for example the pill, it suppresses the endogenous secretions and replaces it with the exogenous hormones. So the hormone levels chart is dramatically different then and much more leveled out. And this helps a lot with conditions such as endometriosis. Another feature of the CHCs is their hormone-free interval, or the HFI. So traditionally, the HFI would be 7 days, and that was just intended to superficially simulate natural menstruation, although it's actually not a proper menstrual bleed. So however, the HFI is associated with adverse effects such as headaches and mood disturbances. And in addition, the 7-day interval also increases the risk of contraceptive failure. So should the person forget to restart taking the pill after the 7-day break, you can shorten or even exclude the 7-day HFI. So suggested regimens include shortening the HFI to 4 days, or excluding it completely, is just having a hormone-free interval once every 3 months, so that you would only have a bleed 4 times a year. HFIs don't typically apply to progestogen-only pills. These are normally taken continuously without a break. Apart from the latest progestogen-only pill containing drispirinone that I'll come back to later on. So now I'm going to go over the generations of combined oral contraceptives, or COC for short. So I am actually focusing more on the pill rather than other forms of CHC. So these are also based on when they are made, but not necessarily on what generation the progestin contained within it is. So initially there is an overlap between this and the progestins generation categorization I went through earlier on, but the two will diverge a little bit towards the end. First generation COCs are those containing norethisterone. These are not used much and have been superseded by the second generation and third generation pills or fourth generation pills. So, and just wanted to point out that medroxyprogesterone is not used in a COC formulation. It's really only seen as a depot injection. For the second generation COCs, there is levonorgestrel with 30 micrograms of ethinylestradiol, which is the typical dose of ethinylestradiol in most COCs. Levonorgestrel is also used in the IUD Mirena and in the emergency contraceptive morning after pill. What makes the levonorgestrel COC stand out is that this is the combined hormonal contraceptive formulation with the lowest risk of venous thromboembolism. Levonorgestrel, however, seems to be the most androgenic and may be more likely to be associated with acne, hirsutism, and lipid disorders than the other COCs, including norethisterone. However, it does generally seem to be well tolerated and is the most used progestin in hormonal contraception. After the second generation COC, new progestins were developed to try and remove these androgenic side effects. So the third generation COCs contain desogestrel and gestadine, which are third generation progestins. These third generation progestins still have androgenic activity, but as a COC formulation, have less androgenic activity than levonorgestrel COC. In the case of gestadine, because it has the highest progestogenic activity, lower doses can be used. And overall, this reduces its androgenic effect and even improved lipid profile, that is increase of HDL cholesterol and reduction of LDL cholesterol, which was great. But then it was found that the third generation COCs actually had increased venous thromboembolism risk compared with levonorgestrel COC. And the mechanism behind this doesn't seem to be completely clear. In Hong Kong, gestadine is in the brand name Harmonet, which has a lower dose of ethinylestradiol, 20 micrograms as opposed to 30 micrograms. So this would lower the venous thromboembolism risk, although lower ethinylestradiol levels are associated with breakthrough bleeds. And in the UK, gestadine is in the brand name Femidine, but this actually has the standard 30 micrograms of ethinylestradiol. Finally, we come to the fourth generation, where progestin-wise was the biggest advance in the evolution of progestins, with drospirenone being the first and so far only progestin derived from spironolactone. In addition to its anti-mineralocorticoid action, which it got from its parent compound, it is also anti-androgenic. And so far, the only progestin which is both anti-androgenic and anti-mineralocorticoid. So it should have even lower incidence of androgenic effects and improved lipid profile. And in addition, may help with bloating and water retention, which is a common complaint with pill users. However, it is still associated with an increased risk of VTE in comparison to the second generation COCs. So it could be speculated that this is somehow related to the reduction in androgenicity. Drospirenone came out under the brand name of Yasmin, but it's now available generically. And the same drug company has brought out another formulation called Yaz, which has a lower ethinylestradiol content and a shorter hormone-free interval. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about venous thromboembolism or VTE. So VTE is one of the most notorious side effects of the pill. The risk should be viewed in context. The VTE risk is associated with ethinylestradiol and more so with ethinylestradiol combined with the third and fourth generation progestins. It is true that your risk of VTE is more than doubled when on a second generation COC and 5x'd when on a third or fourth generation COC. This almost pales into insignificance when you compare it to the VTE risk you get when you are actually pregnant, and even more so when compared to that during the postpartum period. However, this isn't to say that the risk should be disregarded. Although the VTE risk is small in healthy young women, the risk may become more significant in older women and smokers who naturally become more at risk of CVD, and people who have a history or a genetic predisposition for VTE would be advised to go on a progestin-only formula or a non-hormonal method of contraception. So let's come back to the fourth generation COCs, where the newer fourth generation COCs are trying to move away from using ethinylestradiol. The next COC after Yasmin came in the form of Qlara or Clara, which was the first COC using estradiol instead of ethinylestradiol. Estradiol is not as effective as ethinylestradiol at reducing breakthrough bleeds, and it seems that it took a while to find a formula which worked with estradiol. So this was the first one that worked, which was with a progestin called dienogest. In addition, it also needed to be a multiphasic formula as well. Note how much higher the quantities of estradiol here are, 1 to 3 milligrams per pill versus 2 to 30 micrograms of ethinylestradiol per pill in traditional COCs. Dienogest was originally formulated in Germany and left out of the progestin generation system I went through before. It is a so-called hybrid progestogen, as it is a testosterone derivative but behaves more like a progesterone derivative, as it doesn't have androgenic activity and even has some anti-androgenic activity. The signature characteristic of dienogest is its potent activity on the endometrium, which might be why it works with estradiol with bleeding control. Dienogest on its own is also licensed in the management of endometriosis, and Clara itself is also licensed in the management for heavy menstrual bleeding. There are a couple of drawbacks to dienogest COC. The multiphasic formula is a little bit complex, and so it makes it a hassle to work out what to do should you forget to take a pill. And secondly, it's a lot more expensive than the previous generations of COC, as estradiol is more expensive than ethinylestradiol. The expense has kind of made the uptake of Clara on the low side. It came out around 2010, so it looks like there isn't enough data to show whether it really has reduced the risk of VTE. A second estradiol-containing COC came out not long after, brand name Zoelli, and this contains the progestin nomogestrel, and this one is a progesterone derivative. So unlike Clara, Zoelli is a monophasic formula, but however, it's also quite expensive. And also, even though nomogestrel is meant to be anti-androgenic, Zoelli COC still had more reports of acne in clinical trials. And similarly, so far has not really been shown to be any more beneficial than the more traditional COCs. Zoelli is available in the UK and in Europe, but has not been approved in the USA. It also doesn't seem to be available in Hong Kong either. And then after Zoelli, the latest non-ethanol estradiol containing COC has come out. This has gone back to using drispirinone with an estrogen called estetrol, and this is a natural estrogen which is normally found in pregnant women. So note here that the amount of estetrol here is pretty high, so it's 14.7 milligrams. In the US, under the brand name of Nextstellis, and in Europe, brand name of Drovelis. It's only come onto the market a year ago. Only time will tell how well this formula will do. So that is the end of this part two. I hope you found it interesting and informative. Stay tuned for part 3, where I go into progestin-only pills and the adverse and beneficial side effects of hormonal contraceptives. Thank you for watching.